What's up, guys? It's Marius from Audio Judgment, and today we're gonna talk about how to assemble a crossover board. You get the design right, you have the circuit diagram, and now it's time for the assembly. While there are some things you need to be aware of when you do your crossover build, people usually stress about the looks, because why not make something pretty when it sits inside a speaker box and nobody can see it. OCD people, it's real. So in this video, we are going to talk about the options you have in building a crossover board, and of course, you will have my approach on crossover assembly. Besides the electrical components, you will need some other items. First, you need some kind of board to place all of your components. Mainly, this can be a wooden board. Presumably, you made your box out of MDF. You can use scrap MDF for the crossover board. However, plywood would be a much nicer option, as it looks better and it's lighter also. Another great option would be to use those perforated crossover boards. These are nice because all of the connections are made beneath the board, so all the clutter is hidden under the rug, while on top you are all the components neatly arranged. Let's talk about the size of the board. The wooden board can be cut to whatever size. The perforated board comes in standard sizes. So my advice is to get one that matches your size requirements. Although, if you get a larger one, you could trim it a bit, but it will not look as nice. In conclusion, the minimum size of the board is given by the amount of components you have. If the board is too small, it cannot accommodate all of the components. The maximum size of the board is given by the woofer cutout of the box. Most likely, you will place the crossover inside the box after the enclosure is already built, so you have to fit it through the woofer cutout inside. If the crossover board is not a square, at least one side needs to be smaller than the diameter of the woofer cutout. A word of warning here. Even if your board is smaller than the cutout, that doesn't mean it will fit inside the box. You have to watch out for one thing. If you have large inductors or capacitors, don't place them on the sides. Even if your board is the correct size, these large components will hit the extremities of the woofer cutout and the board won't fit inside. For this reason, you have to place the large components on the center of the board, where there is enough clearance. There is another scenario to look after. Let's say you have a very complex crossover with many components. Therefore, you need a large board. In addition, you have a lot of braces inside the box, so there isn't any obvious place to place the board. In this case, you can split the board into two smaller boards and connect them using wire. That way you can find the needed space inside the box. Now you have to find a way to connect the speakers and amplifier to the crossover board. Cheapest option is to solder them directly, so you don't need anything. But many choose to use some form of terminals. And you can use screw terminals, spade terminals. These are used so that the board is clean and you can attach the speaker cables later without soldering. You can even go on the cheap side and use those plastic connectors that you can cut individually. Furthermore, some like to use connection bars to easier connect components between them. These are mainly for the wooden board where all of the connections are made on the top side of the board. Another thing that might be popular is to use a ground bar. If we look at the circuit we are going to build, we can see that we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 ground points. These converge into a single spot, so having a common ground point like a ground bar might make the job easier. Now all that is left to do is decide how to place the components on the board. Literally, there are no rules on how you place the components on the board, except when it comes to inductors. Now I'm going to link into the description the guy who made this article and how you should place your inductors. But here is the short version. Try not to place the inductors close to one another. depending on how you place them, if they are too close to one another, their value will slightly change. You want to avoid that, but don't stress too much on it. If you have to place them close, just make sure they have different orientation and are not on the same plane. Next, we have to figure out how to stick the components to the board. You can use hot glue or zip ties. For the zip ties, use the smaller 2.5 millimeter ones with the highest length possible. I think 200 millimeters is the max. My advice is to use both hot glue and zip ties, especially if you want to place the board on the back panel, for example. The bottom panel is the place where is the least amount of stress, so hot glue should be enough if you plan on placing the crossover board there. Another thing I want to mention when fixing the coils, if you have those air coils with the plastic casing, the first thing that pops to mind is to use a screw through the middle to fix it to the board. Problem is that the screw is made of iron and you are basically transforming an air core into an iron core, which will significantly increase the inductance. So please don't do that. When it comes to the practical example, I will use the crossover diagram from my previous video with the MTM speaker. I'm going to use a perforated board and a screw terminal set. It has 6 connections. In plus minus, tweeter plus minus, and woofer plus minus. Even if you have 2 woofers, they are wired in parallel, so we wire both of them in the same spot on the screw terminal. What do I like to do is to switch the positions of the connectors. Normally you would have a positive in, negative in, positive tweeter, negative tweeter, and positive woofer, negative woofer. But I like to switch the positions a bit like this. It isn't that intuitive if you hand this passive crossover to someone else, but it has its benefits. While the input and the woofer are in normal positions, the tweeter terminals are a bit far apart. This shouldn't be a problem as long as you are aware when you are making the connections to the speakers. In return, it will be much easier to solder as we have all the negative terminals clumped up into one spot. Before I start building, I like to draw everything out on a piece of paper so I get a feel on how I should place the components. If I get a better idea on how I should place them, I can easily make the correction. If you start building directly and then you decide to move a component after you hot glue it to the board, it ain't gonna be that easy. You want to place the components in such a way that minimal additional wire is used. Ideally, the components should be soldered directly to one another and only use wire if you have to. Now, don't stress on this too much. It's not the end of the world if you do use some wire. Now that everything is cleared up, let's get to building. Now, as we saw on the last part of the tutorial, I placed some rubber gasket. You don't want any rattling coming from the crossover, and this seems like a good solution. We are going to screw the board directly to whatever panel in the speaker box, and this rubber gasket will serve as a spacer so that the board doesn't bend, and there is equal pressure when you screw it in place. And that's pretty much it. Don't forget to like the video, subscribe if you want to see more DIY audio videos. Have fun with your audio project and see you in the next one. Peace!